You are listening to the Hiking Radio Network, where we talk the walk with shows by hikers about hikers for everybody.
Welcome to the Trail Dames podcast, where we speak with women who love to dance upon this earth. So my friend Carla is always quoting this great Mary Oliver poem. What are you going to do with this one wild and precious life? And it's something I have to tell you, I think about it all the time. I not only think about that in terms of me, what am I going to do with my life, but so often I meet women and I think to myself, oh, wow, look at what she is doing with her one wild and precious life. Some women's lives, they just strike me as being what this poem was totally written about. Well, today's guest is Marina LeGree. She's the founder and director of Ascend. It's an organization that's focused on empowering young women in Afghanistan. Marina and her team, they do this through mountaineering. They take these young women and they climb giant mountains. And not only is Marina's story amazing, but the story of these young women that she's helping, well, those stories, they're just extraordinary. So sit back and enjoy the story of what Marina is doing with her one wild and precious life. Afterwards, hang out for a few more minutes while I share a few more trail journal entries from my own attempt at an Appalachian Trail through hike. My name is Anna Huthmaker. My friends all call me Mudbutt. And today you're listening to the Trail Dames podcast. Hey, Marina, it is so nice to finally meet you. I was talking about you in the intro and all the great things you're doing with your wild and precious life. So thank you so much for being on the podcast. We're glad you're here.
Thank you for having me, and thank you for using one of my favorite quotes.
Oh, do you know that quote?
I love Mary Oliver, yes.
Oh, do you know one of my good friends actually started her business? That was the motivation and inspiration when she read that. And her business is called Living Wild and Precious.
Oh, I love that.
Well, I tell you, I told everybody at the intro, I said that when I hear that quote, I think about it all the time. And when I see women, I'm often thinking to myself, oh my gosh, look what she is doing with her wild and precious life. And when I heard about you and learned about Ascend, that is exactly what I thought. I was kind of overwhelmed by that. And so I want to actually start, because I haven't really told our listeners anything about you. So I want to start with the whole idea of you are born and raised in America. Is that right?
Mm-hmm. Washington State.
Washington State. But you do all this stuff in Afghanistan. How did that happen?
Yeah, it wasn't a logical path, definitely. I come from a very small town in Washington State called Stevenson, population 1,500, if everybody's home. And my parents traveled a bit when they were younger and exposed us to other cultures. And I just always wanted to do something abroad. And I studied international affairs for my first master's. And before I finished, I wanted to go to the field, as they say, and kind of try something and see which path was the one for me, because a lot of my classmates were joining the State Department or doing USAID work, and I wasn't quite sure I was fit for that sort of structure. So I took a job with the International Organization for Migration that happened to be in Afghanistan, and I hadn't chosen Afghanistan. It wasn't really my wish or even really on my scope. This was 2005, but that's where they sent me, and I loved it, and I stayed on for 18 months instead of what was supposed to be 5. And they promoted me to sort of a real job. And I just continued to stay. And, one job led to another. And I was there full time until end of 2008, and then came home and continued to be involved in Afghan issues. And here we are. It was 2015 when I finally decided to, or 2014, I decided to launch Ascend.
Well, actually, so tell me something, because I love to travel, but when it comes to a place like Afghanistan, all I know is what I see on the news. So when you, do you remember what it was like when you got off that plane the first time
Yes.
and walked? Tell us what that was like.
It was January 2005, and I flew from Baku, Azerbaijan, into Kabul, which is a route that no longer exists, on a rickety plane. And coming into the airport, then they hadn't really cleaned it up. So there were all kinds of bombed out aircraft littering the runway. And it was pretty grim. It was January, so winter in Kabul is also not pretty. And everybody on the plane was either kind of a weather-beaten looking humanitarian worker or a couple government officials. But there weren't that many of us back then. This was long before the surge and all of the US kind of involvement. Yeah, so I was a little nervous and but also just excited, ready to get started.
Did you have a moment where you were like, what in the hell am I doing in the middle of bombed out aircrafts? Because I mean that,
Yeah.
now looking back, we think, oh, that's brave and how cool and everything. I would have been scared to death.
Well, I think my risk meter has always been a little different than the average bear. So I was pretty happy for the adventure side. I mean, of course love my life and I wanted to keep it, but I was up for the adventure. I was unattached at that time, and I knew that I was working for a very good organization, a serious international organization with lots of people there. So I figured they would look out for me. And then very quickly also I bonded with Afghans. I mean, my staff and colleagues were really good friends to me, and that created a security bubble around me that, that stuck with me over the years and that made it fun. If I was afraid all the time, I wouldn't have stayed.
Right. Well, did you speak the language when you got there?
I would say I can solve my problems and I have eavesdropping capability. That's pretty good. I really should have just studied Dari from the beginning and learned to read and write, but I never imagined that I would stay. It was a 5-month contract I had signed, and 5 months turned into, another year. And then the next job offer I had was for another year and it was too good to turn down. So I just, I kept staying. But then my next jobs were in the East where they speak Pashto, and it's much more difficult. It was to me. And I didn't think I would stay. I just kind of didn't put in the effort I really should have, but I guess it's not too late.
Well, and I suspect back then you didn't know that the country was going to become so near and dear to your life today.
Not at all. I really didn't expect that. And when I left in 2008, too, I thought, I'm really done. I've had enough. I had a few close calls and I was on to the next chapter of my life. I didn't think I'd go back. But that's part of what propelled me to ascend, because I partly thought that because I was growing cynical, like so many people do who stay a while. And I didn't want to be risking my neck for something I no longer felt really good about.
Right.
And it was a tough time. I mean, the surge started in 2009, and it was just full on war in the place where I was, which was Kunar province in the east. At that time, it wasn't what I wanted to be doing. I was distanced from the population and kind of wary of what I was involved in by then. So I thought, if I ever come back, it's got to be doing something that I can touch and believe in and really be sure that it matters, even if it's something small.
Right. Well, let me ask you, and so the women in that country, I want to know when you first got off the plane the first time, how did it strike you? Because I know you did research and I know you understood what it was like, but being there, what are the women like in Afghanistan in general?
Yeah, they're a riot for starters. They have to keep quiet and be all demure in public. So they're experts in letting it all hang out when they're not in public anymore. And I thought that was hilarious and really fun. Also kind of terrifying sometimes, because I was often the only foreign woman that they had met, especially because I was in rural areas almost all the time. So I often went to places that hadn't really seen any foreigners. And of course, look at me. I couldn't be more white and like different, red
And
hair and the whole thing.
blonde or red, yeah, redhead.
So I had, people touching me and checking my hair. And, women will just feel you up just to make sure you have all the same parts that they do, because they just can't believe you're so different looking and yet you're kind of the same. So there were some like mob type situations I was in houses sometimes where people just wanted to check me out. But everybody was really good natured. And of course, I was in a humanitarian aid delivery job. So people wanted to see me because I brought resources. But we had a really kind of good working relationship, especially with female leaders. I clung to those who I could find and had really generally quite good working relationships with other Afghan women who were also trying to make change. And like my best friend was my colleague who was quite a bit older than me at the time. I think I was like 26 or 27, and she was probably early 50s. And I just clung to her side and did everything that she did because she was very polite, very well brought up from a good family. And she kind of showed me how to be in Afghan culture if you want to be of the right, you know, kind of stature. Yeah. And doors always opened for the two of us. So
how did you like look at these women and think, oh, mountaineering? Because I mean, I understand lots of things. I understand I want to help make their lives better. I want to show the world how amazing they are already. I understand all of that, but mountaineering, were you already a mountain climber yourself?
Nope, I would definitely not. but I did grow up in the Columbia Gorge in Washington, where we went hiking all the time. I lived on a small farm and always outdoors and doing sports. So it wasn't a real leap. But, you know, in that part of Afghanistan, it's real mountains, really high ones. Like Mount Noshak is 24,580 feet. So the thing is massive. And I'd heard about foreigners coming in to climb it from time to time. And because they would come through the province that I was in, Badakhshan province. And I just thought, that's really cool, first of all. Wish I could go, secondly. But thirdly, like most of the Afghans around me, I don't have the resources to do that. It's, you know, limited to people who have plenty of resources, and none of them are Afghans. And what a shame that they have such a spectacular piece of land that's theirs and they can't access it or even think about it. And for the women, I found them to be really fun and in a place that's often so serious and the problems are so heavy and difficult. These moments that I had with Afghan women were like a, you know, there were just a bright light. It was fun. And we could all kind of laugh together. And it was like, you know, balm to the soul to just lighten up once in a while and have a little fun. So to me, the pieces just came together that these are people who are so utterly repressed, the women. They don't get to go outside or do anything physical. There's psychological damage there from everything that they've been through and a total lack of freedom to move. So let's put the pieces together and go do something remarkable. And it will be a message to the whole country about what women are capable of and to be hopeful and to be proud. But also for those women who are involved, it will be a life-changing thing. And once you've, you know, stood on your own 2 feet on top of a mountain, it changes you. You just feel like you've done something and you come down with a little bit more swagger. And I wanted that for them.
Well, you know, our listeners, our podcast is for women in the outdoors and hiking and backpacking. And our listeners, more than anybody, understand that amazing feeling of accomplishment of standing on top of a mountain. Now, mm-hmm. I'm in Georgia. Our mountains are a little smaller than your mountains. but that feeling, I think that feeling is the same everywhere. And to be able to give another woman the gift of that feeling, to me, is like the greatest thing we can do with our lives.
That's how I felt. And that's why I get that question all the time. If I'm not a mountaineer, how did I get into this? And I just thought, yes, I am not a mountaineer, but I can orchestrate those connections. I know Afghanistan. I know how to bring people there safely, and I can figure out the machinery. And there are lots of people who are talented guides and experienced, you know, outdoors women, and they can come and provide the expertise that I don't have. And that's what's happened. We've had some wonderful volunteers over the years who've come and trained the girls and brought them safely up and down big mountains.
I love what you just said, and that's like another whole podcast topic completely. But I want to, you know, that idea that we all have our gifts and our skill sets, and it does not, if we want to start or create something, it doesn't have to be already in our wheelhouse. If, you know, your gifts for bringing people together and organization to be able to use that, that's a great lesson for us all, I think.
Yeah, it's been a journey of just take a deep breath and try it. And yes, I've worked in Afghanistan, but I've never run a nonprofit before. And that is a whole career in and of itself. And that's also why there was kind of a long pause between, you know, the tail end of 2008 is when I left Afghanistan. And I went back a bit as a consultant for the, you know, intervening years. And I was thinking about it. But I learned enough to know that I didn't know enough to run a nonprofit. So I took a year and I went to the Harvard Kennedy School and did a a master's program that allowed me the space to just figure out what I was going to do. And I remember the first day of that program, I had to announce, we all had to give like a 30-second spiel on what was our plan, why were we there. And I announced that my plan was to start a nonprofit and I wanted to see an Afghan woman stand on top of her country's highest peak. And people, I'm sure, were kind of like, who is this sort of radical person? And it took a few years after that. You know, it was August 2018 when we did it.
If I had been in that room, I would have stood up and cheered for you. I'd be like, yes, I totally get it.
Thank you. Well, some of my classmates were awesome in supporting me and kind of helping me shape this idea into something doable.
Well, and so tell me how this happens. How did you go from a classroom in Harvard, and this is my goal, to having your first Afghani woman come up and say, I'm going to be part of your program and I'm going to climb a mountain?
So that's been a process, as I'm sure you can imagine. In the beginning, in 2015, actually, we started recruiting in December 2014, and it was basically self-selecting. I hoped that we could get 6 people who would be allowed by their families to do this and who would be like physically fit enough to make it happen. And so we started with the Taekwondo team, which is kind of a big deal in Afghanistan. And at that time, there were some sports teams in existence, but most of them are through the government. They call it it's the federated system, and each sport has its own federation. And it was really kind of clunky and difficult to work through that system as a nonprofit because we had, you know, we needed to our own program the way we wanted it. So that first year we worked with some Taekwondo girls and some of them stuck with us for the second year. But then those girls spoke publicly about what they were doing. And we started to recruit at schools, and it was a twofold purpose. One was really to just inspire schoolgirls with what's possible and just spread a message of hope and achievement, but also to get those who were really interested to come and apply. So by 2015, it was all self-selected. And then in 2016, we did some applications. And then each year it's grown since then. So our girls, a big part of what they are obligated to do as program participants is to speak broadly after they've finished their activities for the summer. So then they, you know, it's a recruitment opportunity. And now we turn away, like we'll typically interview 40 or 50 people, and we have about 20 open slots every year.
Wow, that's pretty awesome.
Yeah.
So it's growing like crazy. It's inspiring mm-hmm. women. So in general, I actually was I thought I understood what life was like for a woman in Afghanistan just because of what I've read and stuff. But when I was reading on your website, some of the stuff, I read that 80% of Afghani women are illiterate. Is that
yes.
true? Yeah. And I also read that, you know, physical fitness was not something that was common. I read a little thing about one woman, they tried to get her to do a plank and she immediately collapsed. Like, it's so different from our life where we take PE in school and we're at least supposed to be able to walk around the block. So mm-hmm. how did you start off with those struggles? Like, did you start with just a calisthenics class?
Yep, we did. And yoga. Yoga became a really important part of the program just to value, you know what yoga brings. It's such a wonderful thing for virtually everyone. body awareness and valuing your physical abilities and all that stuff. And the girls loved it. It was that quiet moment in an otherwise very chaotic life that they all live, because Kabul is just a big, noisy, dangerous city. And I mean, it has its nice points, but so we just kind of worked up to it. But it's still a challenge because women are so restricted by, you know, by norm there that they can only exercise when we provide the opportunity and the place. So that's a lot for us to provide. And what we're looking at now is trying to get a climbing gym in Kabul that can be used like any climbing gym where you have space for yoga and wall, like plenty of walls that people can climb. Because for an urban based population, that's a lot easier to do than getting out to the mountains every time. But then what we'd like to do is expand our program to the provinces where you can literally walk out your back door and just start climbing. That's something that we hope to do in 2020, 2021. Bring what we're doing to the rural girls, because that 80% of the population, a lot of that is rural. There's a growing love of sports and more opportunities in Kabul. It's not saying it's great, but things are changing. But in rural areas, most people are still illiterate. Yeah, we'd really like to bring some opportunities to them too.
Well, absolutely. I mean, this is a story of everywhere in the world, you know, the big cities where it starts and where people do have more opportunity. And the small town is, there's so much potential for, for spreading your message.
And those girls also, they work hard. They're scrappy. They physically have to do a lot of chores every day. So it would be easier in some ways to work with those populations. Since I'm making like a very large stereotype, but what I saw when I was in Badakhshan, it really was true. Like, city girls are city girls everywhere you go. And
right.
They have a different type of life than village girls who are carrying water and, you know, doing heavy work in the day. So
right.
Yeah, it'll be different. Stay tuned on that. We'll see.
Well, let's talk about this climb. Let's talk about the climb up No Shock. So for our listeners, No Shock is the highest mountain in Afghanistan. And how tall did you say it was?
24,580 feet. It's the 51st highest in the world.
It's a big mountain. It's a big mountain. And your team actually enabled the very first Afghanistan woman to climb it, right?
She did. Yep.
So do you remember when this idea occurred to you that you're like, this is what, well, you talked about in Harvard in the classroom doing this.
Yep. It was the original idea. So I was actually in Kabul in 2009, staying with a friend and heard the news that the first Afghan expedition had reached the top of Mount No Shock ever. No Afghans had ever climbed it until 2009. And it's two guys, including a guy named Malang Daria, who I had kind of known. They're from Badakhshan. So I just thought, this is amazing and so cool that Afghans have done it. And it was a French mountaineer slash aid worker who had helped them and orchestrated this thing. And so I thought, okay, he did it. They did it. So a man can do it. Now it's our turn. I really wanted to build some meaning into it though, where I didn't want to be just a flash in the pan or, you know, invest all of that effort in the symbolism of somebody doing it. But then what does she do next? What happens with her life after that? And I'd heard some cautionary tales about that kind of thing. And I knew it would take a ton of money and effort to get somebody ready to do that. And I wasn't like, it's a symbol. That's what it is. It absolutely is a message, but there needs to be something that underlies that message and that's more sustainable. So I wanted to build the program around it so that we can have some stars like Hanifa, who did the No Shock Summit, but that there's also a broader population of girls who get to just learn how to hike and camp and climb, and they don't have to be superstars, but make this kind of a more in-depth program for everybody. And we hope that Hanifa is the first, and there will be more and more big. There's Afghanistan is full of mountains to climb, and we're just getting started.
And full of women that can climb them.
Exactly. Yeah.
So how many women were part of that initial team to climb?
For the No Shock expedition, we had four. One of them, she's our program coordinator, so her leadership on site was important, but she had a back injury, so we knew that she wouldn't be making the summit attempt. And then it came down to guiding ratios, basically, where we had to make a decision whether all of the other three would go for the summit or the other two who were less fast and less strong would take a seat in order to enable Hanifa the best chance to go. So they chose the latter option in spite of some tears and because they were super disappointed, of course, but the two of them just didn't have as much experience or speed as Hanifa had. So then it became just Hanifa, and she was really brave because she doesn't speak English at all. And the guides we had, one is Norwegian and one is American, and neither of them speaks any Dari. So the idea of communicating, you know, Hanifa lost sight of all of her friends and ability to communicate and all of that. And she just said, let's go for it. I'm in.
It's amazing. So I want to tell our listeners that on your website, there is a link to Outside Magazine did an article about this. Mm-hmm. It's all about the expedition. And it is one of the greatest things I've ever read. But they talk a lot about what it was like, the interpersonal dynamics, and what it was like for the team to have to make that decision. Does one person go and she wins for the whole team, because it really is, or do you all count it as an educational exercise and turn around and go home? Mm-hmm. And it really struck me, this, first of all, in mountaineering, this is a thing I know that's common, but that idea of working so hard, but you've got to know that your end goal is definitely going to happen. Does that make sense? How do you know? Like, mountaineering is one of those things that so often you don't reach it. And how do you, first of all, how do you teach the young women that, because I just imagine their hearts being broken and them crying on the side of a mountain when they've worked so hard, come from challenges that we as Americans can't even imagine, you know. But, and then how do you tell them that in a language that's not even your own?
They were heartbroken, and it was the hardest part of the expedition, especially for me, because I knew how much was riding on the expedition being a success one way or another. And I told them consistently since the beginning of starting Ascend that it's not about the summit. It's about we make an effort and we go, and that mountain isn't going anywhere. So if we don't do it this year, we're going to try it again and again and again and again until we do it. But I said that until I was blue in the face, and it doesn't matter. They applied so much pressure to themselves. It was very frustrating because they just don't have the perspective. They're young. Like Shagufa, she was 19 then, and Nikki was 18. So that's very young to be climbing big mountains. And as you say, more often you fail, and you need to get used to that failure. But they don't have the luxury of being sure they can go out and try it again. They don't know. This is all given to them, and they are terrified that this is their only chance in their life, and it will, if they blow it, they'll never have another chance again. So we spend a lot of time trying to reassure them and demonstrate that Ascend is here to stay. Our program is available to you, and every year we're going to go do stuff and try to kind of ratchet down the pressure. But Afghans are also a very competitive society. I get it. I'm competitive too, but it becomes destructive at some point, where their families also were with zero understanding of where they were going or mountaineering as a culture, any of it. They interpreted this as you either summit and you're a success, or you don't and you're a failure. That's it. And so we spent a lot of time also trying to tell their families, like, support your daughter by showing her that you're proud of her no matter what she does. I don't care if she only makes it to base camp. She's still done a thing that matters. And yeah, so that was really tough. And we worked a lot with the two girls who I'm talking about who wanted to summit and weren't able to. They're still very much in the program. They're central to our program. Shagufa is a program assistant, so she's staff. And then Nikki is one of our strongest climbers. So I hope that they continue. Like, they're really just beginners in this climbing career. I feel the pressure in running Ascend to find the resources to keep providing opportunities for them. Because nobody goes out at 18 with, you know, 1 year of training and goes and climbs such a giant mountain. And then Right. That's it. You know, it's just, it's a little unrealistic. So, you know, I want them to keep getting better. And they are, they're getting stronger and savvier. And now they can plan their own trips. They know how to communicate and to pack better. And, you know, all the things that you learn with experience.
I found it very interesting because I come from a music background. So everything is about preparation, classical music, preparation, perfection, the audition. You know, and you either get the audition or you don't. And we are always trying to teach our students that journey is every bit, if not more important than the destination. So
absolutely.
You know, and I guess I always kind of thought it was I never gave it much thought, but that it was a Western ideal, this self-imposed feeling of completion of something. But reading that, I realized, no, this just actually may be a human ideal, that it's just kind of built into us.
It is. And boy, I hated to see the girls with that kind of heartbreak. And, you know, I'm old, I'm the same age as their mothers. So there's only so much I can say that resonates with them. But when they came back and they were in tears and they were depressed, and I went the next day with Nikki, and it was the highlight of the whole trip for me, because we just had an afternoon to go climb. I was like, well, here we are. We're just waiting for the others who are going up high, and there's only, you know, let's not waste our time. And base camp was at 16,000 feet. So I wanted to go, you know, climb, and I'd never been that high in my life. So we went around and we just had a blast and experienced again what this whole thing should be about, which is like the joy of being outdoors and pushing yourself. And Nikki was in front of me. I just followed her, and I figured as high as she wants to go, I'll just follow. And we got up to about 18,000 feet, and we were clambering over a glacier basically in our running shoes, because we was just going for like a light walk. It turned into something more. But I could see she was proving to herself that, you know, she still had it. And I think that the girls have taken that joy and that confidence that comes with climbing, and we'll see. I mean, time will tell how much they stick with it and what other achievements are in their future, but I'm optimistic.
Well, and I really want to put this in perspective, because, you know, we're talking 24,000 feet, 18,000 feet. The highest I've ever been is 14,000. That was a really big mountain. It was a really big climb. You're dealing with altitude already. You know, if you come hike in the States, for the vast majority of the States, you're not getting anywhere near that. Mm-mm. So you know, we're talking about, oh, they went to base camp. That's already way higher than I've ever been. And so to me, what they all did already was so extraordinary. And I think all three of those women are going down in history as being groundbreaking, completely and totally groundbreaking. And I hope that they can all understand that. So I actually wanted to kind of ask a little side question too. So my ideas of Afghanistan are between men and women, this dynamic. So now you have Hanifa climbing. Are there any other women that went with her to the summit, or was she with an all-male crew at that
point? The person, so what we had was a Norwegian guide. She's not a registered guide, but she's an incredibly experienced climber, Vibs Seflund. And then Emily Drinkwater, who's a well-known guide in the U.S. And there was a film crew with us as well. So Emily's primary responsibility was the film crew. Two of them did make it to the summit, a guy named Sandro. So the three who made it to the top were Vibs, Hanifa, and Sandro. So Sandro was filming. Vibs was cheering Hanifa on all the way. Emily was like almost to the top, and then she had to go back down with one of the people from the film crew. Actually, Teresa, who wrote the outside article. She got pretty close to the top. But so we wanted it to be an all-female crew as much as we could. Sandro was very much a male. but it was Vibs and Hanifa.
Well, and actually, my thought was that were there any cultural worries about hiking with men as part of a team?
Yeah, that's been a long-term effort of ours to overcome that, because absolutely. And we have to always have a very clear buffer around the girls. Male foreigners are in a slightly different category, but if the girls are seen to be just hanging out with foreign dudes, you know, that's a real problem for them. So I was there in large part as a chaperone. We've kind of normalized it now. Their families trust us that any man that we bring is a trusted, you know, protector of the girls as much as I am. We've had a few, like our partner in Norway, a guy named Thomas, he led a trip to Pamir just last month, and it ended up being Thomas. Sandro went along again and captured it on film, and then three of our girls. And I couldn't go. I have small children, and I just couldn't go take a month out and go. So it was just the five of them. 5 years ago, I never would have attempted something like that. But now the girls and their families, they know us. They know how we operate. And also the girls are much more assertive they really co-led the trip with Thomas. So it's okay. These things are surmountable as long as people know each other and know that there's like a real track record of trust.
It's all about that trust, like you said.
Yeah.
One of the things that I loved reading about this climb, but then really all the other work that you're doing with Ascend, is your work with self-esteem for young Afghani women. And it's so interesting because in America, you know, we always talk about self-esteem and confidence and all this kind of stuff. But I read in one of the articles that one of your women said, Shagufa talked about when she was growing up, believing that girls were worthless. And she said there was an old story that her grandmother had told her that when a girl crosses underneath a rainbow, she'll turn into a boy. So she actually spent her childhood chasing rainbows. And this really struck me. I can't imagine, I don't think I've ever met a woman who had a childhood where she felt that level of worthlessness. I can't imagine it. So is that inherent in all the young women in Afghanistan?
Yeah, it's
yes.
It's tragic to me. And that's why I want to do this, because everything is set against women. And girls are not, it's crushing. And they live with that their whole lives.
It is crushing, but it's also to me extraordinary that it looks to me, looking in from the outside, like in a few short years, you founded Ascend in 2014, is that right? Mm-hmm.
December 2014.
In a few short years, you've taken women and gone from that to women standing on top of a mountain or on top of a base camp, which probably never also saw Afghani women, you know, that's an incredible exponential growth in self-esteem and confidence.
It is. And when I have a bad day, which sometimes happens because running nonprofits is really hard, especially running them in countries like Afghanistan. And I have to think about the girls because it's, you're completely right. And Hanifa is the story, her story gets told most often, but it's 100% true. And it is 100%, it'll rip your heart out. It still, like when I see her, she inspires me to keep going. Also Freshta, who's our program coordinator, they were both born with nothing, just nothing. And Freshta was fortunate to be born into a family that was a bit better off, and she didn't have to deal with child marriage or any of that stuff, but she was extremely poor, a lot of problems within the family, and she ended up getting an education, and we hired her. We just posted a vacancy and interviewed her, and we picked her, and she has turned out to be an absolute stud. I mean, she just is really strong. And when she was very shy and quiet when she first came to Ascend, and I had pinned her in more of an administrative role, but she really wanted to try climbing. And she's the one that had the back injury for no shock, so she wasn't able to go for the summit. But she, her bright moment to me on that whole trip was, we had troubles even starting the trip because you have to have like three different types of permission from the local authorities. And they made it way harder for us than they needed to because it was a bunch of women. They wouldn't let us pass without a certain letter from a certain district governor who was out of town for an unknown number of days because of a funeral and blah, blah, blah. So the police had actually stopped us. And Frishta and a journalist who was with us were leading. They were the first to go. And it came, so they argued their way past the police and it wasn't working. And Frishta finally said, basically, we're going to walk up the hill now. You can shoot us or you can let us go, but we're going.
Wow.
and they went. And so that's the type of assertiveness that she displays now. It is amazing to watch. And she has to fight every single day because look at what she's up against, you know, an entire culture that says she shouldn't be allowed to even be there. She certainly shouldn't be allowed to walk somewhere without a man. She shouldn't be allowed to talk to a police officer. None of it is permissible according to so many people in Afghanistan. And she just says, nope, off I go. Yeah, it's motivating to keep building, keep going. And also because, I mean, look what happens in our country. You can't take anything for granted. Women have to fight all the time. And I really do see that as our primary objective with Ascend is to equip these women with the tools to live a successful life in their own country, which is a very tall order.
That is a tall order. Well, one of your women, she said, quote unquote, I want to stand on the highest point, strong on my feet, to be strong, to lift up those who have fallen and be a hero for women in Afghanistan. I want to be a hero. Was that Hanifa?
Yes.
My question for you is that inherent desire to be a hero for women in Afghanistan. Do you think that those words lived in her, for her whole life when she said she was a little girl, and that Ascend helped give her the strength to act it out? Or do you think Ascend actually created that dream?
I don't know, because what I know of Hanifa, she was kind of the walking dead when we met her. She had had a really, really terrible life. And some of this has been written about publicly, but she's shy about it, basically because she doesn't want her relatives to read about it. But yeah, she was suicidal, and she was a divorcee at age 16 or 17. And Shagufa is her third cousin. So Shagufa asked me, she was already part of Ascend, Shagufa asked me if we could add her cousin, which I didn't really want to do because we don't, you know, I wanted to stick to protocols with how we take people on. But when she told me just a little bit about the story, I said, yeah, bring her. Let's see what happens. I did see something in Hanifa that very first day. I remember we had workouts at the gym, and we were doing actually calisthenics. We were doing like a old school push-up, sit-up, run laps kind of test. Hanifa had never done anything like that before, and she couldn't do a sit-up or a push, nothing. But when it came to running, she was like, it was supposed to be a jog for warm up, and she was sprinting around the track. You know, she really wanted to show her dedication. And there's just something really endearing about her. And of course, my heart went out to her with what a story she had. And there was nobody in her family that was going to advocate for her except Shagufa and, you know, a distant cousin. So pretty quickly, she took to like every opportunity we gave her, she grabbed it. I think that spark was there all along, but she was so badly mistreated and so powerless in her situation that it got buried, you know, to the point where she didn't want to live anymore. I think coming to Ascend, where it was a safe space where she had teammates and there were a couple random foreigners like me who were encouraging her and saw something in her, but She had a place to be for the first time in her whole life. She had never been like outside the house. She cleaned houses and was divorced from a horrible abusive husband and thought, you know, she was just going to be a burden to her family because she was unmarriageable at that point. You know, her future was really, really bleak. And now look at her. You know, so I think what we would need to provide is a bridge, because Afghanistan is full of Hanifas. I think she's remarkable in her own self, absolutely, and she's a really unique individual. But so many women are desperate for a chance, and we just need to provide the opportunity.
If any of our listeners are like me, they're sitting here and they're going, how can I help? Like, honestly, what does the SEND need? What can we do to help further your dreams and your passion for these women?
Our biggest priority right now is to establish an office in Badakhshan province where we can reach those rural populations that I'm talking about, who can just go out and climb right out their back door. So we need funds to do that. And we are setting up a dedicated fund for that so that we can try to launch it in 2020. That would be, I mean, donations, obviously. Every nonprofit always needs is just money, because that's the only thing that makes things tick. And our recurring donors and our sponsors of girls are kind of magic for us. They give us that month-to-month certainty that we can keep delivering the program the way we've planned. So sign up for a monthly donation, and it starts at $5 a month. And we have one donor who gives $500 a month, whatever, wow, you know, is manageable. Yeah, I can go on about the nonprofit side of things, but we're basically volunteer run. So you can be sure that the bang for your buck is pretty outstanding with a SEND. But, and you know, you saw my home office. This is how we roll. But there's other ways, like Sponsor a Girl has been a new thing we've tried this last year, where we can connect people directly to one of the girls. And so it's $110 a month pays for the programming for a girl for that month. And then that you can, you know, have a direct link and do Skype with that girl a few times a year and that sort of thing. It's just really fun. Another huge way to help us end is to simply spread the word. We still have a very small profile, generally, despite some great media coverage. But yeah, I kept us very low profile for the first couple of years because I wanted to see how security went. And I didn't want to put the girls at risk unnecessarily, but we feel like now we're okay. And we need people to know that we exist. So share our social media. We're on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. For a few brave souls also, we do need volunteers every year who go to Afghanistan to be instructors. It's not for everyone, but it's an awesome experience if that's what you want to do. And we have 5 trips every year where we do kind of, the first one is Backcountry 101. So it's just, you don't need any advanced skills for that, but teaching the new girls how to camp properly and climbing and all that. And then every summer we do one big expedition, something ambitious, like maybe No Shock again, some other larger 21,000 foot type mountains. So if you're interested in volunteering, we do take volunteers too.
So, and for the listeners of the Trail Names podcast, that idea of volunteering, the Backcountry 101, that is our wheelhouse. That is what we do. Because when you first said that, I thought I could totally go to Afghanistan, but I can't, you know, like, I can't really jog 5 miles or anything like that. Yeah. But boy, I can teach someone to dig a cat hole, build a fire, all that, leave no trace. I don't know if that's a thing there, but you know,
it is.
So that's awesome. So yeah. I would not be surprised at all if we got some trail dames that went, I want to go to Afghanistan and do that. You know, it's interesting, nonprofit work in general. I'm like you, I didn't know anything about one before I started my own. And this is what I learned. Nonprofits need funds that of course everybody kind of understands that. But the further afield you go, the more that's important, because we can collect outdoor gear and backpacks and sleeping bags, but getting that to Afghanistan is its huge thing, and it costs so much money.
Yeah.
That really, it's better to provide the funds so that you can get stuff where you need it. And so I just want to say quickly that we learned about you because our Trail Dames Charitable Foundation learned about you. We were looking for places to give some financial support. And so, and I'm so happy that we found you.
And yeah, me too.
Oh, I want all our listeners, like, share this recording. Don't share it for Trail Dames podcast. Share it for Ascend and share it for Marina and the work she's doing, because this is important work. And I don't know a single woman that wouldn't be really moved by this conversation and by what you're doing.
Thank you. Yeah, it's been an incredible ride. running ascent. And like I say, there's some low moments because it's really hard. And it's basically 24/7, 365 days a year with the time difference in Afghanistan and all of the details that have to be looked after. But it's also been really inspiring how many people step forward and how many people see something that they care about in our mission and are willing to throw themselves behind that. And the girls, they feel it, they do. And yeah, even on my worst days, like I said, I just need to talk to a few of them and I remember why we're doing this and it does matter. And we see kind of the paths of their life shifted a bit. And one of the things that I didn't talk about, but I should bring up is we're often asked, what are the metrics for this? Like, what do our girls do when they finish with Ascend? Because we're not producing a bunch of mountain guides. So what's the point in all this training? Which is a fair question. So mostly what the change that we see that is the most significant to me is, first of all, the squishier notion of improved self-esteem. And we do surveys when they enter the program and then when they exit, and we see them carry themselves differently, be able to speak publicly, be more physically fit, just easier socially with their friends, et cetera, et cetera. So that's one. But the second thing that's the most crucial to me is that their families allow them the time to be in the program, to finish their schooling, possibly to go to university. Most of them go on to study at university, and there's lots of private and public universities in Afghanistan, which means they're not getting married at 16. They're not having children at 17. They, you know, all of the statistics that go along with delaying marriage apply to our girls. And it just kind of wedges open a couple of crucial years where they're allowed to just pursue their own path. And that's the biggest win for us. And that's what we want to keep doing.
Well, to say it's extraordinary is kind of an understatement as far as I'm concerned. And I want to encourage everyone that listen to this, please go check out the website. It's ascendathletics.org. And it's a gorgeous site, by the way, 3 tiers for your website. And like I said, dig in there and read some of those articles and check out the photos because it's quite extraordinary. And what I'm hoping is that, Marina, I hope you'll come back in the future and tell us more about your next expedition.
I hope so too. I would love to. There was a big one last month and we haven't written about it yet on the website because we're just getting the materials together. But that little group led by our Norwegian chapter head, they did a 6,000 meter peak in Pamir. So it was, I think, I always forget the exact, 19,045 feet, I believe. So it was a big one. And
that's a big one.
We'll put some pictures up soon. It's absolutely beautiful. The, you know, grand snowy peaks and all of it. They didn't get the peak that they wanted, which was about 21,000 because it was just too crazy. The ridge line was way too steep. But they did a big one. And next summer we'll go for something big again. So yeah, check out the page. And also please sign up for the newsletter if you like to understand what we do, because there's only so much we can put out publicly. And the newsletter is kind of our closed circuit of people that opt in to be, you know, informed about our activities. And we share a bit more detail in there about the girls and what we're doing.
Awesome. I'm going to sign up for the newsletter as soon as we sign off from this.
Excellent.
Thank you so much for being on the Trail Names podcast. This was a delight for me. So,
me too. Thank you so much. And we really appreciate all the support from you guys. And we hope we'll be in touch.
We'll talk again soon.
Sounds
good.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
I'm going to dance upon this
earth. And I'm going to find joy in all this madness. You know, I mentioned that I would share the links to Marina's website and her social media and all that information. It's in the show notes. But I want to really encourage you to go grab a cup of tea, sit back, and just really climb through Ascend's website. The stories and the videos that are there, they are breathtaking and they're beautiful. And it will suck you in for a nice long time, I can promise you. I want to add, if you love meeting women like Marina, women who are doing wonderful things with their lives, then you're going to want to come to our Summit 2020. 3 days of classes, seminars, speakers, and workshops. It's all focused on women in the outdoors, encouraging us, educating us, and celebrating us. You can find out more about that at thetraildamesummit.com. And finally, I want to share these words with you. This is written by Hanifa Yousoufi. She's the first woman to climb Afghanistan's highest mountain. I was born from nothingness. My mouth should be sealed. What should I do with a trapped wing which does not let me fly? I have been silent for too long. but I never forget the melody. Since every moment I whisper the songs from my heart, reminding myself of the day I will break this cage, fly from this solitude and sing. I am not a weak poplar tree to be shaken by any wind. I am Afghan woman. June 10th. Good morning. When I woke up this morning, the sun was shining and the day was already starting to feel warm, warm. I was so glad that the rain had moved on. I don't really mind hiking in the rain, but if I don't have to, I'm happy not to. Pirate stopped by as I was packing up and he told me to make sure to check out the waterfall north of here. He gave me directions on how to find it and he took off down the trail. He's a really fast hiker, so who knows when or if I'll see him again. I can tell you this, I loved our time at Trent's. I stopped by the store to say thank you and grab an egg and cheese biscuit out from under the heat lamp, and I headed out up the highway. Logging trucks were still whizzing by, and the heat coming off the asphalt was fairly oppressive. I can tell you I was glad to see the trail cutting off into the woods and up the mountain. I have found that I don't have to hike very far before the noise of the highway falls away and the temperature drops a few degrees. Instead of smelling exhaust and creosote, I'm smelling green again. Ah, I just love it. I hiked for a little ways before seeing the side trail to Dismal Creek Falls. There's a blue blaze on the tree, and as always, that blue blaze gave me a little bit of a thrill. The Appalachian Trail is marked with white blazes, rectangular marks painted on trees, rocks, and fence posts. When you see a blue blaze, it actually means it's a side trail to water, to a view, or something cool. The blazes have actually come to stand for your approach to hiking the AT. White blazes are pure. You are there for the Appalachian Trail. You may stop off to see other things, but if you consider yourself a white blazer, you are a purist at heart, and you always come back to that white blaze. Blue blazers are all about the adventure, mystery, and the surprise that might just be around the corner. Most people are a mixture of the two, but I will give you three guesses as to which one I am, and the first don't count. So I took off down the short blue blaze trail to the falls. When I got there, I looked up to see Pirate sitting there. Well, I guess that answers my question as to if or when I may see him again. He hung out for a few minutes before telling me to enjoy the falls, and then he took off. If I didn't know better, I would think he was keeping an eye out for me. It's a kind of a nice thought, though, because AT hikers do that. We watch out for each other. I still don't feel 100% part of this community, so it feels good to think that someone else knows that I'm out here. I hung out for a while at the falls, enjoying the water and the sunshine. But finally, I did haul myself to my feet and hike on. I had to be careful. I could lounge the days away next to grocery stores, waterfalls, and gorgeous views. And before you know it, October will be here. I spent the rest of the day in a nice, easy groove of climbing and descending. I didn't see any other hikers for the rest of the day, and I found myself just humming nonsensical tunes, making my way down the trail. I would love to let you think that I'm having a deep, profound, solve all the problems of the world thoughts. But no, my head is fairly quiet, and I'm just simply content. And I'm headed north. Love, Mudbutt. June 11th. Today was one of those days that feels meaningful. Do you know what I mean? Nothing extraordinary happened. There were no giant revelations or earth-shaking events. Just small things happening that felt like they were really important. My day started like normal. I woke up to the sound of birds and my tent was damp with dew. I will say I do wake up sore and frankly I'm pretty smelly. But thanks to Tylenol PM, I sleep well. So mostly I wake up feeling pretty ready to take on the day. After another breakfast of my favorite, cold bagel and peanut butter, I brushed my teeth and I quickly packed up before hitting the trail. This morning's hike is neat because the trail keeps dipping down into these dark tunnels of rhododendron and mountain laurel. They aren't blooming this time of year, but the leaves are dark, dark green and shiny. And coupled with the fact that there are big groves of them down in the gaps, the whole thing feels a little Lord of the Rings to me. I'm here to tell you, if Aragorn comes running out of the woods and kidnaps me, please tell my parents that I went happily. No ransom payment is necessary. Around lunch, I hiked down into another gap, all dark and mysterious. I figured I would stop at the Doc's Knob shelter. I got down to the shelter and I stood looking around. I have to say, it was just a tiny bit creepy.
No one's around. The shelter's all dark inside. And there isn't much sun shining down this far between the mountains. Just when I was thinking that I might just take my lunch elsewhere, I heard a voice cry out, "Hey, Mudbutt!" I looked up, and there was Sidewinder. You may remember Sidewinder. He was with two of his friends, Parkway and Booble, way back in Georgia. We all shared campsites several nights in a row. He's one of my favorite people from those early days. He's outgoing and friendly and just as nice as he can be. It was awesome to see him. We sat down on the edge of the shelter. We had lunch together, sharing stories and catching up. The other guys have left the trail, and he's headed towards Maine by himself. It was an easy conversation. Me eating the tortilla with cheese and him scooping spoonfuls of peanut butter out of a jar. Then Sidewinder turned his head to look at me, and he said seriously, "Mudbutt, you belong here. You belong here no matter what anyone else says." I said, "Thank you, Sidewinder," with a smile, and we cleaned up our lunch and said goodbye, him loping off up the trail. As I followed him slowly, I kept thinking about what he said, and I kept wondering what made him feel the need to say it. I guess I could feel all insecure about it. I mean, I do realize that the unspoken words in that statement were that other people had been saying that I don't belong here. Normally, I would chew on that, worry about it, and feel all insecure about it. But I just couldn't really find it in me to do that. What he said actually made me feel really good. Because he's right. I can feel that in every part of me. And I love that he said it. I'm a slow, approaching middle-aged woman. And honestly, I'm pretty unique out here on the Appalachian Trail. Sidewinder is the quintessential thru hiker. 20-something, fit, agile, and free-spirited. I guess I feel like if one of the regular AT folks feels like I belong, well then, who am I to argue with them? It was just a cool conversation. Later that afternoon, I hiked up onto a ridgeline and finally into the hot sunshine. This is so different from the hiking earlier today. I can catch glimpses of views between the trees, and sometimes I see houses, roads, farmlands way down below in the valley. I'm only maybe 6 or 7 miles away from the road, but suddenly it feels like I'm days and days away from civilization. I'm totally surrounded by the forest and the trees, and it hits me that I am totally self-sufficient. I mean, it's one of those things we all know. The whole purpose of actual backpacking is to carry everything you need on your back. I can hear you all rolling your eyes at me and muttering, "Duh, Anna." But for the first time, I really felt it. Like, I could stop right here. I can make camp and be perfectly safe, happy, and healthy. Or I could hike 5 more miles, take a right into the woods, and stealth somewhere more remote. And I would be perfectly safe, happy, and healthy. I have to tell you, it was the most freeing feeling ever. My destination doesn't matter because I can make it anything I want. And that right there might just be one of the coolest feelings I've ever had. Tomorrow, I'm finishing up my solo leg of the trip, and I'm headed back down to Parisburg, where Bumpkin is waiting. The foot's good. My heart and my head are good. And life is good. Love, Mudbutt.